You're listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network, now the largest new media platform on the web, and your number one source for after-show entertainment. Very good, Gene Johnson.
AfterBuzz TV. From the AfterBuzz studios in Los Angeles, California, presented by Maria Menounos and streaming live thanks to Akamai Technologies, this is AfterBuzz TV's Being Mary Jane After Show.
We'll break down tonight's episode and get you all the latest news and gossip. And now, another post-game wrap-up show for your favorite TV show.
It's AfterBuzz TV's Being Mary Jane After Show.
Mary Jane!
You better sing it, lady. I love you, Mary Jane.
I'm not a singer. That's a shame.
Do you?
That's it.
Oh, Lord have mercy. Welcome to the AfterBuzz show recap of Being Mary Jane, episode 2, Girls Night. And I'm your host, Megan Thomas.
And who are you lovely ladies?
Well, I'm Fahnia Thomas.
My cousin from a different cousin family.
And I'm Tiona Hobson.
And I'm Ashley Gray.
And we have a special beautiful guest with us today. You are not going to believe who showed up on this couch. The beautiful Miss Latarsha Rose. Hi. Give it up.
Thank you for having me.
Yes.
Thank you for being here.
And we know who you are. You are Dr.
Lisa Hudson.
Mm-hmm. On the show. Tell us about what it's like to be on set.
It's great. It's so much fun. And I just feel, it actually feels like home.
Does it?
That's great. I know that sounds really corny, but it's true. It really does.
So tell us some of the things that you did to prepare to be Dr. Lisa.
Oh, Dr. Lisa Hudson. Well, I have some friends who are OBGYNs. Okay. So I just sort of reached out and got a sense of what their academic experience was, sort of the journey to being OBGYNs. And then also I have a Dr. Lisa Hudson book that I sort of, it's an inspiration ideas book. And just sort of a journal, I guess, for Lisa, for research and just things that popped up for me, wardrobe, background story stuff, and I sort of carry it with me.
Oh, very nice. Awesome. Do you get to pick some of your wardrobe, or is this just your idea of what she would wear on a regular day?
It was just my sort of idea of things that I foresaw for her.
Okay.
But it was very much a collaborative process. Ruth Carter, who is amazing, she's the wardrobe designer. We took me to a store, and it was really fun because there's some things I walk by and I'd see a dress, and you're like, it's like you're shopping with someone you're not sure if you can spend the money. And I was like, oh, that looks really nice. And then once I got a sense that I could sort of pick things out, I was like, oh, can we try that? She's like, yeah. I was like, oh, I like this.
Yes. It's always nice spending money on someone else's dime.
I know.
Yes, amazing. And so we see that as, you know, as Dr. Hudson, we see that you are kind of tormented. Mm-hmm. You know, the first episode, you took some pills to just go to sleep.
Yeah.
But we don't know if that's true. Is it true?
Were you just trying to take a nap, or were you trying to be out for, you know, a lifetime?
And that will be revealed.
Okay. We just had to ask.
Well, there is a confessional. I don't know if you've checked it out, but on BET.com, there is a confessional that I do from Lisa's point of view about what happened.
Okay.
So I guess I could discuss that a little bit. Just sort of talking about why she did do it and the things that maybe be weighing her down and took her in that direction.
Okay. We're excited to see what's going on.
Because we were a little concerned. We thought maybe she needed to be on a 5150 hold.
Like, immediately.
Because, you know, as a doctor and then taking too many pills.
Can you explain what that is? Because I still...
The 5150 is the psych hold for 48 hours. when you can be held after you do something extreme like that.
Suicide attempt.
Suicide attempts.
Like when Britney Spears went crazy.
Yeah. But oh, after 48 hours, they have to release you. This is when you they can hold you without your consent.
Right.
And then after the 48 hours, they have to release you, or you can stay on, like, if you give them consent.
Do you have to pay for that?
Yes, ma'am. Yes. If you don't have insurance.
But and that's what I believe David was alluding to in the first episode when Mary Jane came back home and he said, well, she needs help.
Right.
And Mary Jane's like, oh, I'm her help.
Right.
Yeah. Yet another thing that Mary Jane takes on her plate.
Right.
So she could have needed a private one.
I mean, if it was my doctor, I'm not sure how I feel.
having her
at work the next day.
What would you say is the best thing about this show and this particular role for yourself?
First of all, it's my first series regular. Mm-hmm. So that
congratulations.
Thank you. So that is the amazing part of it. But also for it to be about a really, really interesting, complicated woman with other complicated women. I remember when I got the first of the pilot, my part was, it was small. You didn't really get to know much about my character other than that she was a doctor. And so that was just in the pilot script. But when we went to series and I got the actual set of scripts to read, I got on the plane and I started to read them. And literally, and Robin Lee was sitting behind me and she said, did you read the script yet? And I was like, no, I just got them. She's like, oh, read script one. Just read it and let me know what you think. She's sitting behind me and I start to read it and I was like, I'm not going to work to just show up and pretty. I get to be an actor. I actually get to do things that are dark and twisted, and that's what I love. Right. That this character is so complicated and varied, and they're, I think, well thought out characters.
Mm-hmm.
And that's exciting. And I never know what's gonna come up or come out of my mouth. The fact that Lisa didn't vote for Obama.
I know. I'm appalled. I just clutched my pearls on that one.
Most black people don't admit to that.
But I could understand it.
Right.
Absolutely. Because economics.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Right.
As a doctor, right.
Tax season is coming up. Exactly. We can all relate.
Great. What's the craziest thing that has happened to you shooting while being on set?
Oh, that's a good one.
It's a good one.
I don't think anything really crazy. Yeah, let's marinate on that one.
Yeah. What's the set like? Because you guys have a lot of houses that are involved and they're all beautiful. Are you guys on location a lot? Are you in the studios?
We were on location for most of the shoot. Nice. And it was awesome, especially walking into these homes that are just, you feel as if you're walking into the character's home and you get a sense of each character being so different. It was awesome. It was amazing. And then the set design was great. It was fun.
Speaking of the different characters, was this your first time ever meeting, you know, the characters like Gabrielle Union and Omar? Was this your first time ever meeting them, like in real life?
No. I have known Gabrielle for a few years through friends, actually. Robin Lee and then... yeah, so they're really good friends. So I've gotten an opportunity to really interact with her, get to know her, and and share some good times.
Oh,
and Omari, though, first time.
Awesome. Mm. So how was that? We're all like, I'm like, okay, I guess I'll ask the question. how was it for, you know, meeting him for the first time?
He is such a presence. Mm-hmm. He's just someone.
I bet, but
he's just so down to earth.
Right.
So down to earth, and so he's sort of a wise soul.
Yeah.
He just can. He can look at you and tell you about yourself.
Wow.
And he really taps into who you are as an individual. He has that ability, and it reveals itself in his work. He's just really truthful.
Right.
Shoots from the hip.
Since this is BET's first 1 hour scripted drama, why do you think in this age of, you know, Bad Girls Club and Reality Wives and Love and Hip Hop, do you think it's so important for, I mean, females, African American especially, to have this type of television show and to watch it amongst all the other stuff that's out there. Mind you, I love all the ratchetness too, but I think that this generation coming up, like some of us grew up with the Cosby kids.
Right.
Why do you think that's important now to have a show like Being Mary Jane?
Well, I think it's important because it shows you real women. Mm-hmm. Women who have careers, mm-hmm. who have strong relationships with their friends. It's not always about fighting. I mean, I have really good friends who support me and get me through my life. Right. It just shows you the value of friends and relationships and the struggles that women have just balancing their lives. Right. And I think so often with reality, it's reality, but it's also a farce.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So here's an opportunity to get some insight, sort of love and career and family.
Right. And I think that's what I like about this show, because I was having a conversation with one of my homegirls, and you know, she's me and her, we're just like the women in the show. However, she's very successful, and she just mm-hmm. said, you know, I find it really hard to believe that a woman like Mary Jane would go back and be a homewrecker and all this stuff. And I'm like, you know, I think that's the beauty of this show, is that these women are flawed. Like, they're not perfect. Unfortunately, we would like for Mary Jane to be a heroine and just to be amazing, but unfortunately she's real, and she right. has a lot of issues, and she has flaws, and I'm sure your character does as well, as we'll see.
Absolutely. And that's the thing, the characters are flawed because we as human beings are flawed.
Right. Yeah.
And I can never know what's going on in someone else's mind and their heart. So I could never say, really, I mean, we could say, oh, I would never do this, I would never do that. Mm-hmm. A strong woman would never do that. You don't know what's going on, for example, you don't know what's going on behind closed doors right. when mm-hmm. someone's alone. And on the other side of that, Mary Jane, because now I feel like I'm protecting Mary Jane as Lisa. Mary Jane didn't know.
Right.
She okay. fell in love.
Mm-hmm.
She went all the way in, fell in love before she actually found out.
Right.
And so then she has this person who she loves, finds out that he's married, but then he's coming to her with information it's not full value, is at full value. So she doesn't know what's really going on with his marriage and his divorce. So I feel for her. I feel for both Mrs. Daniels, Avery Daniels, and Mary Jane. I mean, love is hard enough when you just right. straight and narrow.
When right. there's two yes. people.
But when you add that third one, man, man doesn't get complicated.
Right.
So are you team David or team Andre?
I am team Mary Jane. Good answer. Seriously, because that everybody's like team David, team, you know, Andre. And I'm just like, Lisa needs Mary Jane to have the guy she's meant to have. And I don't know if either of them are the ones.
That's what,
because guess what? Lisa's the one that's going to be there to help pick her up.
Exactly.
Or, you know, sort of pull her down.
Yeah.
Not pull her down, like try to put her down, but sort of pull her out of the clouds when she's not really seeing the truth of the guy.
Right. Right. And so that brings us to this episode.
Yeah.
We see that in this episode, it starts off with Mary Jane going to the wonderful nest egg that her and Andre have built at the hotel, where they get their getaways and their love making on. And he proposes to her.
I mean,
I'm sorry. I wanted to throw
a crappy proposal.
So crappy.
He didn't even get down on a knee and say, you know.
And the fact that he then said, I need to give Avery an answer. I need to tell Avery something.
What does that to do with us?
Exactly. Exactly. Why don't you make a decision?
Why are you with your wife asking another woman to marry you and then saying, wait a minute, if you say yes, then I'll leave her, basically. But if you say no, then maybe I should go work things out. To me, it seems like he shouldn't be with his wife. If he's willing to go ask another woman to marry him, then clearly your marriage is over. And maybe you should, you know, start over and, you know, for your own children's sake, so they don't grow up in a household full of hate.
Right.
Maybe it's better to separate and, you know.
And take some time.
Take some time.
Clean slate.
Clean slate. Start all over. Maybe Mary Jane's not the one, but your marriage seems like it's not in a good place.
Right.
It's as if he has her on a layaway plan.
Mm. Yes.
Like, here, let me give you the ring or the box. Hold on to it. and then I'll come back after I go home.
Right.
To my wife to see what's going on backwards. There.
Do you remember the song that Candy wrote for Kim Zolciak? The ring didn't mean a thing. That's all I heard. I was like, oh God, please, like, throw it in his face, like, and walk away.
And he tried to say this, which I was like, this is the classic player line. I tried to pray you away.
Wait, would it suffer or surrender?
Right.
Like, yes. Suffer, yes. Please, like, just a thousand times over.
I don't know. I think for me, it was clear. Walk away. Mm-hmm. Mary Jane, walk away. Mm-hmm. This man, any man that would propose to you in this way, he's still married. He hasn't even made a decision about that. And he wants to make a future with us. And, you know, he's saying all these beautiful things. And what we do here determines what I'm going to do when I go home. Like, all of this is so wrong. Mm-hmm. And the answer is no.
It's very junior high.
It is.
Yeah. And I honestly believe that we do not really, in terms of relationships and social structure, we don't really grow beyond. We don't mature beyond junior high. It's always junior high games. And that's exactly what it is. He likes this girl, but he has this girl at home and yada, yada, yada.
He doesn't want to lose them both.
Doesn't want to lose them both.
Both on the line.
And I think, but it actually, that sort of reflects back on him and his insecurity.
Right.
He needs to have someone. He can't be alone.
Right, and that's revealed to us. Let us know what you think on iTunes. Subscribe to our podcast. Make sure you rate us, comment, give us 5 stars. Tell your friends about it. Did you like Andre's proposal? Was it great? Nope. Was it horrible? Where does it stand on the list of best proposals ever? Hopefully at the end. Let us know what you think. So then that gets us, you know, one of the things that was most profound to me was what her father said to her on their daddy-daughter date. Mm-hmm. He says to her, you know, I can't wait for the man that calls me to ask for your hand in marriage. I'm going to give him a hard time. And she says, that's so traditional.
Yeah.
But the crazy part is her father said something that I think a lot of women need to hear, is which is you're beautiful and you deserve the best. Mm-hmm. You deserve the best. How did she get so far? That's what I need somebody to answer for me. How did she get so far from falling from what her dad has instilled in her to this woman who is contemplating marrying a married man?
You know, I think possibly it's the journey from leaving home, going to college, and then charting your career path. Mm-hmm. And you're so focused. She's so focused on her career. I don't know if you, like, where do you learn to date? We don't have a class on go and learn to date one. And how to deal with rejection, or how to deal if a guy's not treating you well, or if he's abusing you emotionally, because I think there is some emotional abuse that's going on. I mean, I've heard young teenage girls as of late say things such as, I have a boyfriend and I really, really like him, but sometimes he says some really mean things. Mm. And I don't know what I should do about that. I think he has a temper, but they're still there. They're smart girls. They're attractive girls. But I think it starts at that young age. And I think even if you have a really loving family and parents, I don't know. I don't think it's necessarily something that we walk with all the time.
Right.
I think that with Mary Jane, when she initially met him, she was attracted to him and she did fall in love, and she didn't know his backstory. She didn't know that he was married. She didn't know that he had this whole another family. Yeah. And so it was just that she thought she was a girl in love with a guy, mm-hmm. a single guy with no attachments. So then when she's hit with this, oh, well, I have a wife and kids, it's like, man, but I love you. Like, so it's hard for her to walk away from something that she's embedded so many feelings. You know, I really feel like she genuinely loves this guy. Mm-hmm. And now she's like at a crossroads, like, you know I'm not supposed to go back to him, but I love him. What am I supposed to do? And then it's those classic, oh, I'll leave my wife, I'll leave. And then she's like, okay, I know he's lying, but I love him. What should I do? So she's just conflicted. And I think that, you know, she needs to just stay away from him, get with her homegirl, Lisa, have some drink.
Right, right.
And be like, girl, just, like, shake me out of this. And she needs to tell someone. That's right. The thing. Like, you can't have conversations with yourself trying to solve a problem. Mm-hmm. You need an outside perspective. So she needs to link up with Lisa. Mm-hmm. But have some cocktails.
That's also her problem. It's she's Mary Jane. She solves people's problems.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, she's so used to being everyone else's anchor that she doesn't know how to allow herself to, you know, get the help that she needs and open up to her friends. Because Lisa even says it, you know, in the girls' night, you know, when she pulls out the sperm. She's like, how could you get to this place and not even call me when you've helped me through so many things? And I kind of can feel for Mary Jane in that aspect, because as much as I love helping my friends, it's harder for me to open up when I to ask for the help.
Right.
You know, so it's that thing that you have to kind of swallow your pride a little bit and go and get it. And so it'll be interesting to see when or how she finally gets to that place.
Yeah, what her outlet, who her outlet is.
Right now it's sex.
And
I think it's a common thread for Lisa and Mary Jane. Neither of them wants to really let their guard down and let the other friend know. I think it's a hard thing to to really have your friend see your insecurities, or because you, everybody thinks that you have it all together.
Right.
Which I found very interesting at the girls' night, that they were so open with each other, because these are not a really close group of friends from what I could see. So I'm like, wait, so you gonna put that sperm on the table?
That's that alcohol.
Really? And then the stripper, of course, I don't know why he was still there, but he's like, we gotta get the scoop from Mary Jane. I'm like, wait, why are you still here?
First of all, you know me, and you can't know my secrets, because I don't know if you're gonna go sell it to the tabloids.
Exactly, it's like you're a public figure, and you're like just putting that sperm on the table in front of the stripper. I don't get this, but... I mean, whatever. I guess it was the alcohol talking.
He found it amusing.
He did. He thought he was part of the
group. He probably learned some things. Really... He was like, ooh, if that's what women are up to, maybe I should
try flush after.
Right.
I will dispose of my own. Thank you very much.
Right. So we'll talk about the girls tonight, because I want to get into some stuff. But the one thing that I noticed with Mary Jane and her family is this plays into a lot of her conflicting feelings about marriage. She makes the comment she's not sure if marriage is for her. And I think a lot of black women that are professional, that are single, have the same idea that crosses their mind. Well, I'm not married. I'm successful. Maybe marriage isn't for me. What do you guys think about that?
I like to believe that you can have it all. I think that you just have to be patient with it and make the right choices. But I'm a optimistic person, so I don't know.
Romantic.
I'm a hopeless romantic. I read all the mushy gushy stuff too. So I mean, I want to believe that you can have it all, that you can have success, a family, a husband, and a happy life all together.
You can. I totally agree with you. I feel that it takes the right person to have it all with. And if you both are on the same track as far as your goals and his goals, then you're golden. I think you can.
Absolutely. I think you should have that mentality. I love that. I love that you said that, but also be aware that there's going to be obstacles and there's going to be challenges. And it's how you bounce back from that and you treat those as learning opportunities. So I'm with you. I'm sold. I'm sold on the dream
I'm sold as well. However, I also think it's the question also is, what does that mean? What does having it all mean? What does success mean to you? I think it's an individual decision, and I think it evolves over time, and I really think
no one person's happy ending is the same.
Exactly.
Oh, you got like that.
And the thing is that if you're in a relationship and you do neglect your own personal goals and aspirations, then you're going to end up miserable.
Right.
So it's like, you know, find someone, be patient, and wait for that one person that's going to journey with you to the top.
Right. Yeah. Because you have to be happy so that you can offer your
happy
who you are.
Yeah.
So you can share that, because nobody wants that.
Yeah. Right. The one thing that makes me sad about Mary Jane with her family is that she's so quick to get angry with them. And I'm guilty of it too, because, you know, your family is the people who you can snap at. And, you know, they will always love you through it. Every time she has a scene with someone in her family, it starts out so happy. Like when she was watching her dad wash the car and she's walking up. And then in a split second, it just turned to,
when
you
Niecy
know,
comes.
Yeah.
Then
well, that's how it happened.
Yeah.
I sometimes don't realize. I'm like, oh. I tripped over it. I tripped over myself. And
right.
Oops.
I went back to being 12 and having a fit.
So I just did a Britney Spears.
I caught it. I think we all got it.
Have mercy.
A hopeless romantic.
Exactly.
Hopeless romantic.
Hopeless romantic. But I think it's to say, you know, I do believe you can have it all, but I will say this. if you look at somebody like Avery, she seems to have it all.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But sometimes there's a price to pay with that, and you see that throughout this show they're talking about the suffering that comes with the sacrifice and all that stuff. And I think that's part, you see what she says to her husband. You see that she is successful. You see that she's a wife. She's a mother. She seems to have it all together.
She's a career woman.
Exactly. Yeah. But she also says, I helped you. I helped build you up, Andre. I helped make you the man that you are. Now what do I have to show for it except these stretch marks and two kids?
No, she mm-hmm. didn't say she helped. She said she made him.
Oh, she made him.
I built you.
Yeah, yep. I built you.
I built you. Which is the most emasculating thing a woman could ever say.
She took all the credit for that one.
Right.
She didn't went
even,
in.
Yeah.
She didn't even say hard. First giving honor to God. She didn't even say that. She said, I built you. So for me, I think it's like, you know, when you look at somebody like that, and I think that's where the complexity comes. You look at somebody like that. It's a balancing act. She clearly missed the balancing part of her marriage mm-hmm. because you see the fight that she has with her husband. She's like, why do we have to have sex so much? You know, like she missed the boat there. So I think, you know, you can have it all, but I also think there's a very fine line to balance. Mm-hmm. If you don't balance it, this is what happens.
I mean, yeah. if she doesn't want to get up and put it in her mouth, like, give her, cut her chick some slack.
Can she
like,
brush her teeth or something like, first? Can
see,
she,
this is what got him. This is what got them in that place.
Yeah, but that's, yeah,
that's not up. What you can, and that's the thing, like, don't blame it on intercourse. Like, it's more than that. He didn't cheat on her just because of sex.
Right. I mean, but he says that. He says that to her. He does say, you know, I've been trying to get you to see me, who I really am, not who you want me to be or who you've made me to be perfect. He's like, I want you to see me.
And I think also that I built you statement alludes to a problem in the relationship. Mm-hmm. Because obviously the man that you met wasn't the man that you really wanted to be with. So you changed him.
Exactly.
And so maybe... that you have to sort of dig and scratch under the surface. Because I think the sex problem is surface.
Right. Mm-hmm.
In the marriage, I don't think that Avery sees them both as equals. Mm, I think that she, I think that's the problem. And, you know, the whole balancing the marriage thing, it's, yeah, she did drop the ball and she does seem to have everything, but no pun intended.
I'm sorry. You can keep it in.
Oh, dirty minds.
Oh, however, I still don't give. There's no reason to cheat on your spouse.
Absolutely.
None at all.
If you're done, leave.
Exactly. Or talk. Can we talk about it? Mm-hmm. Can I mention counseling to you? Can you know? It's. I'm not gonna. Yeah. It's just not. No excuse.
And no. So, and that, you know, the comment that you just made, if you're done, then just leave, right? And that's so crazy because you look at her parents and you see that her dad is holding out hope that her mother will change and that her mother will be okay with going on the rides again that meant so much to him. And then you see from her mother's perspective, what did you think from that? Because I was trying to understand, like, is her mother just kind of like, well, I'm sick, sorry, get over it? Or mm-hmm. is she more like, you know, do you feel like she's coming from a place of hurt? I can't be who he wants me to be anymore, which is that beautiful long-legged lady getting out of his car at every stop.
I think it's her looking at herself mm-hmm. from the past and she not being able to deal with mm-hmm. who she is now. Because her husband loves her.
Right.
And mm-hmm. he sees her. And he probably still sees the girl that he fell in love with. But she can't see herself. Mm-hmm. I think that's where it starts. Just like Mary Jane can't see herself.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So oftentimes you are your mother, even though you say you're not going to be your mother, you know?
Mm-hmm. You are our own worst critic, I believe.
Yes.
And she's so beautiful. And I totally agree with you. She doesn't see her beauty. And she just doesn't feel, you know, that she has what it takes to keep her boo, but he's not going anywhere.
No.
And that lady,
Catherine.
Can keep it moving. Because I can't with Catherine. I just can't.
She came over to that table so friendly. So and I think that messes with Mary Jane's head as well, the whole idea of marriage. Like, you got this woman coming in here, she's trying to cheat and take my daddy from my mama, and I'm not okay with that. And you saw the little girl come out of her quickly.
So protective. Like, little girl, I saw that. Guard dog.
Yeah.
Very protective.
Like, back away from my daddy.
Exactly.
Right now. But I think that it's a I think that Mary Jane's mom is also kind of using the lupus as an excuse. Right. Mm-hmm. She's letting the disease define her instead of her defining the disease. Mm-hmm. Yep. And so she's kind of given up. And she just has to find that spark to get her back moving, because that's all that her husband's looking for, is that spark again. Because, you know, we talked about it in the last episode, you know, there are, you know, you have the valleys of the highs and lows with lupus, and you don't have to always be in the valley. You can be on the high. Mm-hmm. And so she just has to get out of it.
And I think her family needs her to get out of it.
Right. Because that family, whoo. Mm-hmm. That's a hot Catherine mess downstairs. Waiting, honey.
She said them vultures will, they are there before you say I do. And clearly Catherine is.
And did you see that look, the second look back when she left the restaurant? She looked again and again.
It's ridiculous. Like, you're too old for that, honey.
Oh, I don't die, honey. I know. She's fabulous.
But
she's
fabulous. What? It's really sad because the storyline is so relatable. And people actually act like this. Right. And it's disgusting. And if that, I don't even know how let me just.
Don't trip. They're only getting purses.
I'm like, I just can't. It's just, it's really, really sad. Like, extremely.
Girl, you're always going to be somebody's PYT, even when you're 60.
Don't worry. PYT.
You will be pretty young thing.
Oh. PYT. Pretty young thing.
You know, Michael Jackson.
Oh, yeah, but I.
Catherine is trying to be somebody's PYT. And I love the little conversation, the daddy-daughter date, and how.
That was great.
Oh, yes, yeah. And how he has a conversation with her, and Mary Jane says, you know, she just wants to do nasty things to you. He said, get in
line.
That
was uncomfortable because I'm not saying that.
I don't think I can ever say that to my dad.
Like, oh, no. No.
I would be like.
No, yeah. Me and my daddy, our little dates, I'm not saying anything.
Right. I don't even want to think about my dad in that way. I just want to be like, I don't even want to know. I just want to feel like I came in a Petri dish. Like, you didn't have me for real.
And
like, the way you're
supposed
to. Spending
time with daddy, remembering what it was like to hang out with a kid.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Yes. Not. She got really protective. She just.
Guard dog.
But she shoots from the hip.
Right. She's very protective when it comes to her family, and I think sometimes a little too much, a little, you know, too mean, especially when it comes to her niece, who is Niecy is so heartbroken that boy don't really want to be with her, and, you know, for her to just kind of come off rough.
And I love that Patrick had to explain to her why he was telling her the way that he told her that Dante didn't take her to the doctor.
Right.
He's like, look, your niece is heartbroken. Maybe you could be an auntie and go talk to her.
Right.
Instead of just yelling at her, saying that you knew he was
a low life. And being so disappointed.
Yeah,
right?
And being disappointed. Because sometimes you can be as disappointed as you want. It's not going to make a difference. Mm-mm. It's not going to change things. So the only thing you can do is sometimes they just need some love.
Right.
You That's know? True.
And I think you forget she's a teenager.
Yeah.
Right.
She does have a problem. Or I don't
well, she's good at sex, so
she's
doing what she's good at.
She is a teenager though,
right?
And she's coming of age,
right?
And she doesn't actually have a mother figure. I don't know. We don't know.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, because he is a dad. Here's one thing we'll say about Patrick: he is the father that has custody of all the kids.
Mm-hmm. That's a good thing. That's something.
Speaks volumes.
Yes.
Yeah,
volumes.
Which is great.
Right.
Even though he sells weed.
Is it him
no,
or
no, 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 the younger brother? Yeah,
okay, younger brother. Yes. So then, one thing that also comes up is a conversation with Kara and Mary Jane, and they're talking about work stuff. And something that comes up is the angry black woman syndrome that a lot of black women get the rap for. And she's saying, you know, I am legitimately mad. You, when you mess with my money, I am not angry. I'm pissed. Mm-hmm. And that's anybody, any race, any gender, whoever.
Anyone.
Mm-hmm. Anyone. And so how does it make you feel as black women in this room that people tend to think your anger comes from your angry black woman syndrome when they probably would be just as angry as you if they were in the same situation?
Well, I think it comes twofold, because if we weren't black, I mean, black people, we get the angry black woman. But then as women, we also get, oh, she's just PMSing.
Mm-hmm.
Oh.
So yeah, I mean,
it's the other day, girl.
Right. Yeah, so it comes as a twofold. It's like you can't we get it from both angles, and I think that it's something that we can be better at, because sometimes it is just angry black woman syndrome, but most of the time it is legitimate, and we just have to eloquently speak our case.
Boom.
And if you can defend yourself in a professional manner and you don't sound like, oh, well, she be doing this and she be doing that, people will take you more seriously.
Correct. My angry black woman is Becky. I turn into a white girl.
Kill them with kindness.
And exactly. I am just shooting them with words that I would never speak with on a regular basis.
Absolutely.
And I'm fuming inside. But they would never know it because I'm talking like Becky, even though I'm really pissed the blank off.
Yes, I get very proper, very specific. And I sound like a lawyer.
Yeah, exactly. See, that's the thing. That's me. It's like, it's not the I'm not the one to disguise my emotions. I'm going to give you what I'm feeling.
Mm-hmm. Oh, you're angry black woman. Okay.
Well, it's not because I get upset when people say angry black woman. It's I'm giving you what I'm feeling right now. And I don't get ghetto. I don't get ratchet. I'm very well spoken, but I'm going to look you directly in your eyes. And I'm going to be very aggressive with my words because I'm upset. Right. And I'm going to let you know that I'm upset. And I don't like that angry black woman thing, because if y'all want me to get ghetto, I could. But I'm not trying to do all that. Now, if you want me to be angry, I can be. But I mean, I'm educated, right. So I don't do that.
I think it's a very real topic, though. You know, as black women,
girl, that's a whole other topic. We can have a whole show on that.
Right. On that, but that's real. A lot of black women have come across that people will automatically take your anger as, oh, angry black woman.
And they'll whisper it like,
not
girl.
Fair because it's not fair. It's like, look, anybody in this situation would be just as mad. Mm-hmm. So I get if it's a, you know, a angry tirade, ghetto, off the wall, too much. Okay, I get that. But if I'm legitimately angry, I shouldn't be looked at like an angry black woman just because I'm black and I'm a woman and I'm mad.
I'm just angry, period.
I think pulling out a label and saying, oh, you're this or you're that, is just the person saying, I'm not interested in engaging with you. So it's an easy out. Right. They don't really have to take the time and say, well, what's really going on, and interact. Because no one wants to really interact. So it's just, let me slap a label on you and not even try to understand.
Yeah, because in this episode, she was very well spoken and direct with what she said. Right. I did not see angry black woman at all. I just saw, you know, a woman who was really upset about something that transpired at work. And I'm going to tell you about it.
Right. But I will, in Kara's defense, I will say this. Kara said something that I think as her friend / coworker or boss, she noticed about Mary Jane, and one of the things she said is, you move past reason to your anger. Mm-hmm. And Mary Jane, like you said, she's quick. She shoots off the hip. She's quick with it. So I think sometimes it is legitimate what Kara was saying. It's like you don't stop and go, you know what, wait, hold on, let me think about this. Sometimes she is emotional. Yeah. So I think it's sad that when she does have those moments of being emotional, that it is labeled as being labeled angry black woman.
Right. It's just that's her human condition.
And, I think it has a lot to do with circumstances too, because you have to think about, how did she get there? She's very powerful in her position. And it's like, well, what was her struggle getting there? Did she have, because you can't, come on, let's keep it real. We're black and we're women. We're not going to get anywhere in life being like nice. I'm like, oh, okay, no. In our industry, in the entertainment industry, you have to have a tough skin. Mm-hmm. So it's like, you kind of have to, like, you know, be that tough black girl. Assertive, you know, you have to. And so I feel like, you know, throwing labels at people is not necessarily the correct thing to do. However, in this certain situation, I can see how that can just, you know, Kara can say that.
Yeah, but. And going to your point about, you know, how she skips past reason, if she had stopped to think of reason, I mean, Kara was helping her friend Mark out. Right. You know, his show is struggling and they are clearly good friends. I mean, she walks over to his house and hangs out and has brunch and all this stuff. So I think if she'd been thinking more clearly, she'd be like, oh, well, you know, helping my friend, you know, to keep his job at the station and stuff.
Did she have a choice? Did Kara have a choice to take on
the show? The way it was presented, no.
It didn't seem as if she had a choice.
She just had to do it.
Yeah, so I don't see where the anger...
I think the anger was just because she had to find out from someone else.
She didn't get information. Come tell her. I think she brought Kara... I think they came to the show together.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. Oftentimes that's how producers. And
so she didn't get the news breaking news first.
She should have been involved. Exactly.
Right. And I think
she felt left out.
She didn't get breaking news. Anchors want to break the news.
Right. And Kara apologizes at the girls' night out, which I'm glad they kissed and made up, per se. So we see the girls' night out, which looks so fun, by the way. Who wanted to attend? I did.
You were there.
I know.
You were there.
It was fun, actually.
I saw you.
That was a fun night.
Yeah, I saw you with that stripper and that olive.
I know. You saw I was caught off guard by that.
Yeah.
Were you? I was, because you film and you do what you do when you're filming, and then you don't know what actually gets caught on tape.
Was that your first time seeing it?
That was my first time seeing it. So that really, I mean, you guys saw it. I literally was like, oh. That moment got.
Did you guys get real drinks for that?
No.
Oh, man. No. Sorry.
So what was it like? Tell us about the backstory on set. Oh. Take us to that night.
That night, it was cold. Very cold. I think it was snowing that night in Atlanta.
Oh, wow.
Oh, wow.
But there are a lot of things that happened with food and drink and just the life of the party stuff. And you're never sure what they actually capture. Lots of things happened that night. Oh, yes.
You're not going to give us the tea. Like, you're holding back.
Like I said, what happens on set stays on set.
Okay, Latarsha.
So was it a real stripper?
Oh, no, I don't know.
I know Atlanta has a lot of strippers. I know some things.
So we see that Tamiko, what's her name, Roberts, who took Mary Jane's job at CNN, is invited in, which I thought was weird. Why would you invite her?
Yeah.
I think at one point they were friends. So, and it sounded like Kara had already invited her or something, you know, like, you know, she'd already.
And they are colleagues, and it's a small network.
Very true.
And, you know, friends and.
And black successful women, we should not be each other's rivals, enemies. Yes. We should all embrace and celebrate our accomplishments together.
That's so true.
Yes.
Air high.
Yes.
Air
high.
Boom, boom, boom.
Enemies all the way.
Yes. So a few things are revealed at the Girls Night Out. We see that you, Dr. Hudson, have voted for Obama, did not vote for Obama, and you smoke weed.
Yeah.
Wait. I hope it's medical marijuana. Do you have a card for that?
Hopefully not while you're practicing.
Again,
like, when you see it from PJ.
Yeah. Again, this is our doctor over here.
Right.
You know?
Are you seeing patients stoned?
They just let anyone go through med school.
Oh. I will have to see.
Oh. So she might be doing that. Okay. We got to write that down. In a prediction. And then we also see that the girls are telling some of the different things that they're going through. Like Kara last night got laid, apparently. Mm-hmm.
Congrats.
The intern.
Someone else.
Carlos.
Carlos.
Yeah. A Latin lover.
And then also Braylee Evans' character is, I can't remember her name, but she says that she's dating a married man. She gets gifts and she's like, it's okay because she's a modern day geisha.
She catches men's eyes because she gets the purse.
I just felt that tension in the room when she said that, and it was like the one girl, Kara, her husband cheated, and I'm like, oh, why did you say that? That was the wrong secret to reveal.
Those drinks, honey.
Oh,
a truth serum. You forget your audience, and suddenly the tone can all change.
Right. So she says that, and she makes a good point. She says, I'm basically doing a service.
That's a good point.
No, it's
for her.
For her.
What
she's saying.
Oh, for
she's
her.
Like, that was her good point. She's like, I'm doing a service here. You know, I'm actually helping this man's marriage.
Oh, that's interesting.
Very interesting. And then we also see that Tamiko has revealed some stuff. She bought her own ring. She emasculated her husband. Do you guys think it's okay if a man gives you a ring and it's small that you get your own ring? Or you tell him?
I wouldn't do it right away.
Yeah.
I mean, maybe couple years into the marriage, be like, oh, you know, like, let's go get something.
It's gonna upgrade.
Upgrade me a little bit. Like, you know, there's success and from both of us, so it doesn't feel so much as my money, it's our thing. If I were to do it, I wouldn't have done it.
I would think my husband would know, well, my fiance would know me well enough to not bring me a little trinket home.
Unless that's all he could afford.
But it depends on what he could afford. And also than that, I think that's a sign for her and her relationship.
Right.
That the symbol of it. Because you know, whenever you're at a ceremony, they always say the circle, it's the strongest because it's a circle and it can't be broken. Yeah. Never ends. But the value of it and the way it looks was more important to her than the actual marriage.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Instead of the wedding and the ring and the dress, like, that was more important than the actual.
See, I value it all. The way it looks and the, you know.
So
I just want a beautiful ring.
Okay.
Yeah.
To my future boo. But I think that if someone takes the time to go out and pick something out for you that they think that you'll enjoy and it's what they can afford, then I would be happy with that.
For 365 days, yes.
Yeah. And that 366th day,
you're going down to get me a new diamond.
Or you make sure you insure if you lose it.
Right.
Yeah. I have a tendency to lose things.
It's right. Like if he were to bring me home some flats, knowing that he would never bring me home some flats knowing that I love Hills. It's like, I don't want that.
I think that was not the case. I think in this instance, he just could not afford the ring that she wanted. Okay. Yeah. She's a big, you know, big she's time
got a anchor. She's more successful.
Right, okay. And so she emasculated him and got her own ring. And I think that was the sad part, mm-hmm. is like, you got your own, like, oh, that's not good enough. I'll get my own. Thank you.
But yeah. It's also a question, I mean, that it's going to also depend on how they share their finances.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Because I think nowadays it is a thing where, because the rings are part of the marriage, and I think some couples are putting their money together,
mm-hmm. yeah,
and buying the ring. So it depends on how they're looking at their finances and how that's right. being shared. So I mean, it's an investment, just like you're I mean, they're going to be saving up for the house together.
Right.
Now I'm not saying that I'm gonna, I don't know. I'm just offering it right. as another.
And so of course we were wondering about the sperm from the movie, and now we see that Mary Jane finally brings it out of the freezer, and everyone's reaction is like, ah. But I think Lisa's face, Dr. Lisa's Hudson's face, said a lot. She's a concerned friend, but I think there's something else there.
Me too.
What is it, girl? Tell us.
I don't know. What do you think?
Mm-hmm.
You know,
you
okay.
tell me.
Ooh, I think I know something.
This is a prediction. Everyone, let's share our predictions now.
Prediction.
Oh, we are?
Yeah, let's share our prediction. We're going to throw our predictions in right here.
Now, that scared me. What did I do wrong?
Okay, who wants to start?
I'll start. Mine is a little off the wall, but whatever. So I think that Lisa kind of has a thing for Mary Jane.
I knew you were about to say
because
that.
Because the way she's looking, she's like, oh, no, see, that's my boo. I can't believe this. I think that they're going to hook up. I don't know. Maybe not the next episode. Ooh, look at her. Ooh, I'm right. She's like, ooh, girl, you got it. I really think so. Because okay. It's just too much.
So something. Dr. Lisa Hudson is a lesbian. Yes. It's yours. Okay. I don't know how to top that, so.
Yeah. You don't have to top it. What do you think?
No, don't top it. Yeah, this is interesting.
I think that, I mean, I like the prediction of Dr. Lisa maybe being, you know, girl crush on her best friend. But I also feel like maybe it was more of a, I'm hurt because you just saw me at my lowest point, you know, to the point of, you know, Mary Jane had to stick her fingers down her throat to get her to throw up all the medication that she had taken. And being hurt that she wouldn't tell her, you know, mm-hmm. I'm at this low point in my life where I'm stealing men's sperm. And especially the sperm of someone who I'm never supposed to answer the phone for.
Right.
You know, Lisa doesn't even know that she's been hooking up with David again. And then, oh, look, I have a sperm in my freezer.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Fahnia?
I don't have one. I'm going to pass this week.
I will say this. I think Dr. Hudson she's a friend to Mary Jane, but I think down the road she's going to do something hurtful to her friend. I don't think she's her for real friend, because she's broken. She's her friend, but she's broken on the inside. There's some depression. There's something going on that is so deep that she may end up hurting Mary Jane.
Good.
Interesting.
Interesting. We shall find out.
Okay, so we have one more thing to talk about before we close out, which is Andre and Ashley. Oh, Avery. I said Ashley. Avery.
Well, they always say that the best sex is makeup sex, so.
Well. Do they now?
That's what they say. I mean.
They.
That's what they say.
Do you think they're going to end up staying married?
No. For a while, but eventually, no.
Yes.
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 I think forgiveness is a big thing, and I think more people forgive than we think.
Mm-hmm.
And I think relationships are complicated.
Right.
Good answer.
She knows the answer, and she's just trying not to say it.
No, I don't, actually. I don't. And I think, you know, it's not black and white. It's quite gray.
Right. And I think they're going to stay together. I think, you know, they just needed their truth moment. They needed to get to an ugly point in their marriage before they can start fixing it. So I think it's going to be very complicated on how they fix it. I don't think that they're going to get a divorce, especially after that post-nup.
that she handed him, because she did was it so like, slick.
That was clever. That was clever, honey. And he
didn't sign it.
Because, but that's how she knew he really loved it. Loved Mary Jane, because he didn't want to. Because he knew he was going to cheat
again.
He knew he was going to have some relations.
Can I make a quick reference to Parenthood?
Yes. Yes.
Absolutely.
So did you guys see the episode with it? Because it relates to the ring. The girl ended up breaking up the guy.
Yeah.
She was worried because he spent his whole check, his whole, you know, enlistment
Riber.
Check. Right. Ryan and Amber. So she didn't want, because it's an investment of their relationship. Right. So money and relationships, it's all yada,
and her
yada.
Downgrading her ring was a big issue in their relationship, too. So upgrade it or downgrade it, it's same
men
issue.
Are sensitive. We really need to beware of that and realize that. They're actually more sensitive than we are.
Yes. Latarsha, thank you so much for coming on the
so
show.
Oh, you're
please come back.
Yay. Thank you for having me. Oh, I'd love to. Please. Any other show? I watch TV.
Okay. Well, where can your followers and your fans find you?
BET, 10 o'clock on Tuesdays. Twitter.
Social media?
Twitter. And look out, I did an independent film that will be coming out next year called Chorus Place, and it's it's a period piece set in the 60s dealing with domestic abuse and racial abuse, and so
And what's your Twitter handle?
Latarsha Rose.
Latarsha Rose.
And
where can we find you, ladies?
You can find me on Twitter and Instagram at the Tiona Hobson.
You can find me on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter at Fahnia Thomas.
And you can find me on Twitter at Hey Ashley Gray, as well as on Instagram at Ashley Nina Marie Gray.
As always, you can find me on that Instagram, the Facebook, and the Twitter at Meg Scoop, like scoop of ice cream. Until next week,
You guys, next week, Richard Brooks is going to be here, Mary Jane's brother. So you guys have to tune in and watch next
is
week.
Is he really?
Yes. You got to watch.
Oh, my God. No. Sorry. No, because like, no.
I don't know what just happened.
Spill the tea!
No tea. Storyline. I'm really... Storyline. You gotta, protect storylines.
Okay.
Oh.
Just a little drop.
Oh, but I am gonna take a time out from social media.
Okay.
My neck hurts. I'm literally like...
All right. See you guys next week.
Thank you.
From executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
Buzz you later!
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principal.
Thank you for watching AfterBuzz TV on YouTube. For more of your favorite after shows and interviews, subscribe to our channel here. And be sure to share your opinion on the episode in the comment section below here. We'd love to see what you guys are buzzing about. Thanks again. Buzz you later.